So let's get started. Today we're gonna talk about hypothesis testing. Yeah, so generally statistical method can be divided by descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. Under the inferential statistics, we already talked about the estimation method, and today we're gonna talk about hypothesis testing. There are lots of material under hypothesis testing. I'm trying to go over as more as I can, as more tests as I can in this lecture. So I suggest you to review the slides by yourself carefully after the class. And so this is the outline of today. I will first talk about the hypothesis testing for one population mean. Then we will switch to the two samples from the two different populations. We're gonna compare the difference about them. And then within there, the means of two related populations. So the two samples from two populations depends on the relationship between those two populations. One is that those two populations are related. The other is that those two populations are independent. So under each situation, which kind of test we should use to perform hypothesis testing? So first, let's look at one motivating example. We call it a birth weight example. In this example, first we know the average birth weight in the general population is 120 ounces. Then you take a sample of 100 babies born in the hospital you work at, where in this hospital is located in a low social economic status area. So you find that the sample mean of birth weight, sample mean X bar, is 115 ounces with a sample standard deviation 24 ounces. So you are wondering, is the mean birth weight of low social economic status babies indeed lower than that in the general population? Or this difference just occurs due to the chance or due to the random error? How to quantify this difference, whether it's really this mean weight is different from the general population or not? So in the next, we're gonna learn how to use an objective way to determine which hypothesis is true. So when we talk about hypothesis testing, the first of the thing, we need to identify the parameter interest. In that example, the mean birth weight of low social economic status babies is our research interest. So we denote it as mu. And then about this mu, we first should write down the null hypothesis. In this example, in the null hypothesis, we let mu equals to mu zero. In the example that mu zero is 120, the number from the general population. What's the average baby birth weight in the general population is 120. Under the null, we assume that the mean birth weight of low social economic status babies is equal to that in the general population. This is what we put in the null hypothesis. This hypothesis idea, testing idea, is kind of similar to the notion of innocent until proved guilty. So we start with that the birth weight in the low social economic status babies is the same as the one in the general population. Then we collect the sample, we try to use the data to determine whether we should reject the null hypothesis or not. So in the opposite position, we're gonna define an alternative hypothesis. This is usually where we put our research goal to it. So this is actually most of time our really research interest we put in alternative hypothesis. In this example, we're gonna put the alternative hypothesis be the mean birth weight of social economic status baby is lower than that in the general population. So in the alternative hypothesis, you should write down mu, which represent the mean birth weight in the low social economic status. This mu should be less than 120. Is that okay? You may notice that in the alternative hypothesis, usually there's an inequality sign. either doesn't equal or less or bigger. So if it doesn't equal, that's going to lead to a two-sided test. If it's just less or bigger, it will lead to one-sided test. Here is another example. Let's try to write down what's the null hypothesis and what's the alternative hypothesis. In this example here, we are talking about to compare fasting serum cholesterol levels among recent Asian immigrants to the United States with typical levels found in the general U.S. population. Assume the cholesterol levels in women aged between 21 to 40 in the United States are approximately normally distributed with mean 190. It is unknown whether cholesterol levels among recent Asian immigrants are higher or lower than those in the general U.S. population. So first, our research interest, we define the parameter of interest mu to be the cholesterol levels among recent Asian women immigrants. And then using this mu, we're gonna perform some hypothesis on mu. The null hypothesis is this mu equals to that number in the general population, 190. And then in the alternative is our really research goal. We want to test whether this serum cholesterol level in the Asian women, whether it's different from that one in the general US population or not. So in the alternative hypothesis, we put a mu doesn't equal to 190. Then we want to use the data to perform a test to decide which hypothesis, whether null is right or whether alternative is right. Is that okay? So given you a problem, you first need to formalize it into just hypothesis language. Write down the null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis. And we want to emphasize that those hypotheses must be stated before analysis. Actually, it's stated before your study design. Usually when you conduct some research, you have a hypothesis. Then based on this hypothesis, you design a study. After you design the study, you collect the data, and you're gonna using your data to perform some hypothesis testing to test your research hypothesis. Is that okay? This hypothesis should be decided before your analysis. And also I want to emphasize that you can see under the null hypothesis or the alternative hypothesis, both of them are all about the population parameter. So parameter, just as I said in the previous lectures, parameter is about the population properties. It could be population mean, population proportion, but never is about the properties about sample. We want to perform some hypothesis testing on the population parameter. We're just using the sample data to verify this hypothesis. So you will never have a hypothesis statement about sample mean or p hat. So you never. In the hypothesis, H null and H alternative is always about the population parameter. And also you may notice that we usually use the Greek letter to represent the population parameter, like mu or beta or alpha. So here, after we define the null and the alternative hypothesis, you can see here listed four possible outcomes for this hypothesis testing. In this table, those two columns represent the truth. Yet in theory, we know what's the truth, whether the null hypothesis is right, is the true one, or whether the alternative hypothesis is the true one. So the column represents the truth. And the row represents our result, our conclusions based on the test. The first row is the study is inconclusive. So we accept the null hypothesis. The next row represents we reject the null hypothesis. In other words, we accept alternative hypotheses. So whether we accept H null or H alternative is represented by those two rows. The two columns represent the truth, whether the null hypothesis is true or the alternative is true. So the truth and our result, the combination produce four different outcomes. For this part, it is one, the null hypothesis is true, and we also determine to accept the null hypothesis. So this is the correct decision, right? The truth is H null is right. Then we accept the null hypothesis. And the one below to it, the null hypothesis is true, but sometimes we reject the null hypothesis. We are making a mistake. We are making an error. This is not right. And this error, we call it type 1 error. We're using alpha to denote it. Is that okay? For this cell, this is the alternative hypothesis is true, but after we perform the test, we determine we accept the null hypothesis. So still we are making a mistake. We are conducting an error. We call this error to be the type 2 error, using beta to denote it. The other cell on the diagonal is that one alternative is true, and our test show that we're going to reject the null hypothesis, accept the alternative hypothesis. We make the right, correct decision, then this part is right. And we call it the power. Usually this power is just a 1 minus type 2 error, beta. So in total, there are four different possible outcomes for our hypothesis testing result comparing to the truth. Is this clear? So, okay. So let's look into what exactly was the type 1 error. Type 1 error is happened when we reject the null hypothesis. When actually the null hypothesis is true. So in probability language, this alpha just represented by the probability of given H null is true, we reject the null hypothesis. And this alpha, we should pay lots of attention to this alpha. We want to minimize this type 1 error. Because what? I just said that we usually put our research hypothesis in the alternative hypothesis, right? We always want to reject the null hypothesis to show that our idea, our innovative method in the alternative hypothesis is correct. But when we claim such kind of innovation, we want to be conservative. We don't want to this time we claim, yeah, we reject the null hypothesis, our new method is more efficient, or our new idea is correct. But then afterwards, when we repeat it, we found this is just a false positive. We just made a type 1 error. So whenever we perform such test, we want to minimize this type 1 error. Is that okay? So we are very care about this type 1 error. We always want to minimize it. And the second type of error, we call it beta. It happened when we know the null hypothesis is false, but we reject the null hypothesis. Actually, the correct decision is that when the alternative hypothesis is true, if we accept the alternative hypothesis, then we make the correct decision. But unfortunately, when H1 is true, we do not reject the null hypothesis. Then we conduct a type 2 error. When H1 is true, we accept the null hypothesis. This is make another type of error. This is type 2 error. Is that okay? And then the power is just 1 minus the type 2 error. We want to have the higher power to say that when the alternative is true, we can reject the null hypothesis. Claim our research alternative is right. Let's back to this example to understand what is type 1 error and what is type 2 error. For this birth weight example, the null hypothesis is that we believe the mean birth weight for the babies in the low social economic status should equal to that one in the general population. An alternative hypothesis, we believe the mean birth weight in the low social economic status should be less than the one in the general population. Then what's the meaning of the type 1 error? After we perform a test, we're gonna reject the null hypothesis, accept the alternative hypothesis. Or we do not reject H0, then we reject the alternative hypothesis. So after the testing, you either say H0 is right, H1 is not correct, or you say H1 is not correct, H0 is not correct, H1 is correct, right? You can only pick up one is correct, the other one is wrong. So what's the meaning of type 1 error? Type 1 error is that one H0 is correct, is the truth. The underlying truth is H0 is correct, but you reject the null hypothesis. Instead, you claim H alternative is correct. So the type 1 error in this example is that the probability of deciding the mean birth weight in the hospital was lower than 120. You say H alternative is correct, but in fact, the H0 is correct. But in fact, this birth weight in the low social economic status should equal to the general the one in the general population. Is that okay? This is type 1 error. When H0 is right, but you reject H0. Type 2 error is that one H alternative is right, but you do not reject the null hypothesis. So in this example, the type 1 error is the probability you say the mean birth weight in the low social economic status baby was 120. You do not reject null hypothesis. You say H0 is right, but actually H alternative is correct, but actually it was lower than 120. Is that okay? This way you understand those two types of errors. Another example, for this cardiovascular disease, we know the null hypothesis is mu equals to 190. The alternative is mu doesn't equals to 190. What's the meaning of type 1 error? That is, well, the truth is there is no difference, but you reject the null hypothesis. You decide that the cholesterol levels among recent Asian immigrants are different from those in the general population. This is your conducted type 1 error. And for the type 2 error is that the truth is that they are different. The alternative is true, but you decide that you do not reject the null hypothesis. You claim that the cholesterol level among recent Asian immigrants, they are the same as those in the general population. This is type 2 error. You can see that you cannot make those two type errors at the same time, because type 1 error can only occur if H0 is true. Type 2 error can only occur if H0 is false, alternative is true. So actually, when type 1 error probability goes up, the type 2 error probability goes down. So you cannot reduce both errors at the same time. There's a trade-off between those two errors. But ideally, we want to minimize both of those two type errors at the same time. So general strategy is that when we perform the hypothesis testing, we first fix alpha at a small number, usually 5%. We want to control the type 1 error at 5%. Then within this frame, we try to minimize the type 2 error beta. The power is just 1 minus beta. When we minimize beta, we are maximize the power. Is that okay? So just consider a fixed type 1 error. Then within this type 1 error, we try to minimize the type 2 error. So next, we're going to I'm gonna show you what's the specific steps to perform the hypothesis testing. We're gonna talk about the population mean first. So first you're gonna have a hypothesis. I believe the population mean is 50. Then after you draw a sample, you take a look of your sample mean. Sample mean is 20. So from this sample mean, can you draw the inference about the population mean? Can you reject or accept your null hypothesis or not? It all depends on how you compare your sample mean to your true population mean. So if this sample mean is close to your population mean, you would likely to accept your null hypothesis. If it's far away from your population mean, you're gonna reject your null hypothesis. Then how close is close is the key part. How are you going to make the decision, right? So for this kind of hypothesis testing on the population mean, when the population standard deviation is unknown, we're gonna use the t-test to perform the hypothesis testing. When we talk about the test statistics, this is just a matter of how close the data is to the null hypothesis. So we already got the sample mean. Just like what we did in the last lecture, we just minus is population mean, the number in your null hypothesis, then divided by the sample, the standard error, the standard error of the sample mean. This is the t statistics. This quantity gonna measure how close is your sample mean, is your data, is to your null hypothesis. Mu zero is the number you put in your null hypothesis. The larger the test statistics, the further our data is from the null hypothesis, and the stronger the evidence that we're gonna reject the null hypothesis. And also the following test gonna based on this fact, whenever the null hypothesis is true, then these test statistics follow to a t distribution on the n minus 1 degree of freedom, provided the data from a normal distribution. So all the following calculation is based on this fact. Is that okay? The size of what?
X bar.
Yeah, the size of X bar. You mean the value of X bar?
No, how many times?
Yeah, this is we are focusing on one sample.
Okay.
We draw one sample. The sample size is n. N just determine the degree of freedom of your t statistic, t distribution. Focusing on one sample this time. So I just said that this t statistics under the null hypothesis, it follow to a t distribution with degree of freedom n minus 1. This is under the null hypothesis. So we can under this null hypothesis, we can observe, we can locate what this observed t statistics, where is it on this distribution. If it is far from zero, that means it's far from our null hypothesis. We're gonna reject it. If it's very close to the center, that means this is very close to the null hypothesis. We're gonna accept the null hypothesis. Is that okay? So here, based on that distribution, we're gonna define the rejection region. This region just tell you the range of values of the test statistics T for which H null is going to be rejected. How to define this rejection region? We need to define a cutoff point, a threshold. This we call it critical value. This critical value gonna decide whether our sample mean is too extreme when null hypothesis is true. If it is too extreme, we're gonna reject it. And then the next slide gonna show you this rejection region is depends on your type 1 error, the type 1 error alpha. a typical value for alpha for the type 1 error is 1%, 5%, or 10%. And the conventional number we use in the publication is 5%, just like we did the 95% confidence interval. This 5% is the most conventional number we use in the publication, the literature, and in the research science. Is that okay? So the typical, the most common type 1 error is 5%. And this type 1 error, just the probability of giving null hypothesis is true, then we reject the null hypothesis. Look at this picture. This is show you how to define, how to find this rejection region. And the rejection region usually occurs on those extreme points, usually on the two tails of this T distribution. But on which tail or on both tails is determined by your alternative hypothesis. If your alternative hypothesis is one-sided, for example, for this example, the alternative hypothesis is mu less than mu zero, then the extreme points should occur on the lower tail. Right? This direction just the same as the one in your alternative hypothesis. Alternative hypothesis is you are looking for those extreme points smaller than mu zero, then you are looking at the lower tail to be your rejection region. You want this lower tail, this region has the probability alpha. The type 1 error should be controlled at alpha. So the probability of this region or the probability of T distribution less than this point should equal to alpha. Then using this probability, you can determine the critical value Tn minus 1 alpha is at this time, what's the value of this critical value. Then this is define your rejection region. Is that okay? So then you're gonna calculate, yeah. Yeah, 5%.
Your confidence level is
the probability 90. In this part is 95%. Acceptance region. The probability of acceptance region is 95%.
Okay.
And this is just a type 1 error. The probability you're gonna conduct the type 1 error is 5%. And the rejection region. Whenever after you calculate the sample mean, you calculate these T statistics, you're gonna see whether it's fall into the rejection region or not. If it's in the rejection region, you're gonna reject your null hypothesis. Yeah.
But the level of confidence is like the 95% interval away from the mean, which is zero here, right? So
mm-hmm.
Your alpha doesn't cover the other tail and tail.
This is determined by your alternative hypothesis. You see, this alternative hypothesis is just one set. So if we reject the null hypothesis, we're going to accept the alternative hypothesis. In this alternative hypothesis, you assume that this population mean in the low social economic status baby less than mu zero. It's less than mu zero. So the extreme point is on the lower tail. So this rejection region is always the same as the direction determined by your alternative hypothesis. Yeah, you will be get more clear in the following examples. So here we using the sample mean, we calculated the T statistics. If the one fall into this region, then we're gonna accept it. If it falls into this rejection region, we're gonna reject it. So this is the meaning we define the rejection region first. Is that okay? Here is for the two-sided test. For the two-sided test, it's determined by your alternative hypothesis. In your alternative hypothesis, you say mu doesn't equal to mu zero. So you believe this mu could be bigger, could be smaller than the one you put on your null hypothesis. This is the extreme points could be occurs on both tails. So your rejection region gonna be on both tails. for each one should have the probability 1/2 alpha. Is that okay? So for the two-sided test determined by your alternative hypothesis, you can see the rejection region is on the two extreme tails. And the, in the middle part, whenever your test statistics is in the middle, that indicate your X bar, your sample mean, is very close to your population mean, then you're gonna reject, you're gonna accept your null hypothesis. And then if your test statistics fall into those two rejection region, you're gonna reject your null hypothesis. In this tail, also rejected. If in the middle, you're gonna accept your null hypothesis. Yes. Mu zero is set. Such like in the birth weight example, mu zero is 120, the number for the general population. We in H null we put a mu equals to 120. In the alternative, we say mu zero, mu less than 120, right? Can you repeat it? Yeah, there's a region, there's a set of numbers. This rejection region gonna tell you X bar when you calculate this test statistic. So this is a test statistic, right? When you X bar is the sample mean you get from your data, mu zero is say for the example is 120, you just put your sample X bar and S into this quantity, you calculate the T. This T corresponding to this region gonna include a set, a multiple number. Whenever these test statistics fall into this region, you reject it. Not just one simple number. Okay? So I'm gonna go through some examples. After that example, you will be familiar with the procedure. So we talk about the two-sided test. Then here, back to this birth weight example. We know the general mean weight is 120 ounces, and we have 100 samples, and the sample mean is 115 ounces, and the standard deviation is 24. Can we actually say the underlying mean birth weight from this hospital is lower than the one in the general population? So we're gonna perform the hypothesis test on this example to answer this question. This is the basic frame, how to answer this question. So we need to first elaborate what's the null hypothesis, what's the alternative hypothesis. And then we should determine what's the type of error, what's the significant level. And then using the sample data, we can calculate the test statistics. For this example, the null hypothesis is we believe mu, the birth weight in the low social economic status baby, is the same as the one in the general population. This is null hypothesis. The alternative one is mu less than 120. And we determine to use the 5% as our significance level. And from the problem, we know the sample mean and the sample standard deviation. Then we plug them into the formula. N is the sample size. We can calculate the observed test statistics. This number is negative 2.08. Is it so far so good, right? So from the problem, we can calculate this quantity. Then we know under the null hypothesis, these test statistics follow to a T distribution with degree of freedom n minus 1. So based on the sample size, you know the degree of freedom for this T distribution is 99. After you know the degree of freedom, actually you can draw the T distribution. You know exactly what's the number, what its shape looks like. Then you can find out these critical values. The critical value is just this point because the alternative is mu less than 120. The rejection region is on the lower tail. The lower tail, this rejection region is cut off at this point. This point has the probability 5%. from a T distribution with 99 degree of freedom. So the critical value is determined by, you can calculate it from the Excel T inverse function. You calculate at which time, at which point the error to the left of it is has probability 5%. Here, whenever you use this T inverse function in the Excel, you should pay attention to here. The first element is called the probability, but this function is used to calculate the two-tailed critical value. But for our problem, we have one tail, one-sided. So you need to double this alpha, double your probability to 10%. Because this is called, give you the critical value on two tails. The summation of those two tails has the probability in the first elements. So when you put point one here, actually give you the critical point, make this rejection region for each lower tail is just half of it. So this is, since we are calculate the critical value for one-sided t-test, we need to double this alpha whenever you use the T inverse function.
So that's why you put minus because you want the lower.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. The probability of a T distribution with 99 degree of freedom less than this number, less than negative 1.66, has a probability of 5%. So this way, after you calculate these critical values, you know where is your rejection region. Then you check your test statistics. This negative 2.08, whether it's in the rejection region or not. Negative 2.08, compare this number to your critical value. It's less than negative 1.66. So that means you observe the T statistics. It's in this rejection region. You reject the null hypothesis. So you reject the null hypothesis, say that you decide the alternative is the truth. So the true mean birth weight is significantly different in the low, is different than the one in the general population. Is that okay? This is just a one-sided t-test. Let's look at another example. No. Yeah, you reject the null hypothesis. You result is just whether you reject or accept the null hypothesis.
So in this case, you accept null hypothesis because your alternative hypothesis is way far from.
Yes. Yeah. So this way, this is that we found it is significantly the birth weight in the lower socioeconomic status baby is significantly lower than the one in the general population. We prove our hypothesis is right. We just want to using the data to find the evidence to support our alternative hypothesis. Remember, for this kind of problem, our research goal is to show that the birth weight in the low socioeconomic status, their baby, the weight is lower than the one in the general population. This example just show you, by performing this t-test, we show it's a statistically significant from the one. And then, because we set alpha is 5%, so if we repeat this procedure, there are 5% probability that the null hypothesis is true, but we falsely rejected it. Here we reject the null hypothesis, right? There are 5% probability. Actually, the null hypothesis is right. We should not reject the null hypothesis. 5% probability. Is that okay? So then let's look at another example. This example is two-sided t-test for the cardiovascular disease. We know the cholesterol level in the general population is 190. And then we take some sample, 100 samples, and the sample mean is 181, and the standard deviation is 40. We first write down our null and alternative hypothesis. the null hypothesis is mu equals to 190. We believe the cholesterol level in the Asian women is the same as the one in the general US population. And an alternative is that we want to show that actually the cholesterol level in the Asian women is different from the one in the general population. How to perform a test to determine which one is right? We still use a t-test. The t statistics defined like that. Sample mean minus mu zero. Mu zero is just a number you put under the null hypothesis. 190 is mu zero. Is that okay? Sample mean minus mu zero divided by the sample standard deviation s over square root of 100. You got your t statistics. It's negative 2.12. Then next step, you need to check whether this t statistics, observed statistics, is in the rejection region or not. How to find out the rejection region? The rejection region is determined by your alpha, the significance level, and the degree of freedom. The critical value can be calculated by t inverse function because this is two-sided. The overall alpha is this, the overall probability in the first element, just 5%. Degree of freedom is 99. You got your critical value is negative 1.98 for the lower tail and positive 1.98 for the upper tail. So rejection region is on both tails. Then you check whether this T, observe the T statistics, negative 2.12, is in the rejection region or not. It's smaller than negative 1.98. So we reject, it's in the rejection region. We reject the null hypothesis. Our conclusion is that the mean cholesterol level of recent Asian immigrants is significantly different from the mean for the general US population. Is that okay? Whether it's two-sided or one-sided is determined by your alternative hypothesis. This is critical when you define your critical region. After you define this critical region, just compare your observed t-statistics to this critical region. If in the critical in the rejection region, then you reject your null hypothesis. Otherwise, you cannot reject your null hypothesis. Is that okay? So far, by go over those two examples, we showed you how to perform the hypothesis testing using the critical value method. The critical value method is calculate the critical value from alpha, then comparing and the t distribution, then comparing your observed t statistics with this rejection region. There's another method to perform the hypothesis testing. We call it the p-value method. Yeah, when we conduct the research, we always talk about the p-value. So what's the meaning of p-value? So once we calculate the actual t statistics, we can ask, what's the smallest significant level at which we could still reject the h-null? In other words, it's observed level of significance. In other words, p-value is the probability of obtaining a test statistics as extreme or more extreme than the observed one, than the observed actual sample value given null hypothesis is true. So you first calculate your observed t statistics. Then the p-value is just a probability for under the null hypothesis that the t-distribution could be as extreme as or more extreme than the one you just observed. For h-null mu less than mu zero, the p-value just calculated by what's the probability of this t-distribution with degree of freedom n minus 1 less or equal to than the one you observed, you calculated from your sample data. And this is for one mu, in the alternative hypothesis, mu greater than mu zero, your p-value is defined like that. And then when it's two-sided, you have only one observed T statistics. When you calculate the one side tail, you need to double it. Depends on whether this T observed T is greater than zero or less than zero. And then after you calculate this p-value, you just compare this p-value with your alpha, with your significance level. If p-value greater than alpha, you reject your null hypothesis. If p-value less than alpha, if your p-value greater than alpha, you do not reject your null hypothesis. If the p-value is very, very small, that is the probability for a test statistic could be as extreme or more extreme than this number is very, very small, that means your observed one is really, really extreme, really rare, is far away from the center, far away from the population number in your null hypothesis. That is when the p-value is really small. What's the meaning of small p-value? Then for the small p-value, when the value is less than alpha, you reject your null hypothesis. Okay? So next we're gonna show you how to find the p-value using the same example, the birth weight example. You can see here, we first get our observed T statistics, right? Using our sample mean and sample standard deviation, we can calculate our observed T statistics. It's -2.08. Then the p-value is just the probability for the T distribution with n minus 1 degree of freedom is as extreme or even more extreme than this number, than -2.08. What's the probability of this T99 less or equal than -2.08? Is that okay? You get your observed T statistics, T values. You look at the tail probability cut off by this number. That is the probability for that T distribution is as extreme or more extreme than this observed T statistics. This probability just tells you the p-value, the number of p-value. If this probability is very small, that means your observed one is really on the tail, is far away from center, right? You can see if you observe the T statistics is around the center, then the p-value is going to be very big, bigger than 5%. You do not reject your null hypothesis. If smaller than 5%, the smaller of the p-value, the extreme of your observed one is far away from your null hypothesis, you're going to reject your null hypothesis. Is that okay? You definitely need to know the meaning of p-value and how to calculate it. So for this cardiovascular disease, what's the p-value? You can see this is a two-sided test. The p-value, you calculate your T statistics, everything is the same. For this example, it's -2.12. What's the p-value for the two-sided test? You first, based on your observed T statistics, calculate this lower tail probability, the probability of T99 less or equal to -2.12. But this is a two-sided test, you need to double it because you need to count, the p-value should count on both sides. The probability for this number is as extreme or more extreme than it. The other side also have extreme values. So the p-value is just 2 multiply the number you calculate from here. For this example, the p-value is 0.037. Compare it to the alpha, 5%. It's less than 5%, then your conclusion is you reject your null hypothesis. Say you accept your alternative one, there's a significant difference between Asian women about their cholesterol level to the one in the general population. So far we have already shown two ways. One is that you calculate the critical value, determine the critical region, comparing your observed T statistics with the rejection region to decide whether you reject the null hypothesis or not. The other way is that after you got your observed t statistics, you calculate the probability, the p-value, then compare your p-value with alpha, the significant level. If smaller than it, then you reject your null hypothesis. Is that okay? Those two methods. Next, we're gonna show you the third method. So you may have already related to this hypothesis testing technique with the confidence interval. Here, we're just focusing on the two-sided case. For the two-sided hypothesis testing, you can see that H null is rejected with level alpha. On the tail probability is alpha. And corresponding, the middle part is 1 minus alpha. That acceptance region, just our 100% 1 minus alpha confidence interval, right? So if you can first construct a confidence interval for the population mean using your sample data, you just check whether the mu zero you put in your null hypothesis is in your confidence interval or not. If in your confidence interval, that means your confidence interval covers this H null, then you accept the null hypothesis. If it doesn't cover, that means you're gonna reject the null hypothesis. This confidence interval and this hypothesis testing actually is based on the same underlying distribution. It's the same idea. So actually, we have three ways to test the hypothesis. One is the critical value method. The other is computing p-value. The third one is constructing confidence interval. For example, for this cardiovascular disease example, under the null hypothesis, we calculated the t-statistics. It's negative 2.12. So yeah, actually for the confidence interval, it's not necessary to calculate this t statistics. You just construct your 95% confidence interval using the sample mean plus or minus this critical value, the same critical value you use in your 95% confidence interval and the one you construct your rejection region. So 1.98 is the critical value you calculated under the null hypothesis. Then you times the sample error, the standard error for sample mean. You construct your 95% confidence interval. Then you checked your mu zero, the number in your null hypothesis, whether it's in the confidence interval or not. If in, that means you accept your null hypothesis. You do not reject. For this example, 190 is outside this confidence interval. You reject your null hypothesis. Is that okay? So here, you're just using the technique you learned from last lecture to construct your 95% confidence interval. Then compare the one, the mu zero, you put in your null hypothesis, whether it's in the confidence interval or not. So far, we just talk about for one population hypothesis testing. Next, we're gonna comparing two samples from two populations. Is that okay? So next, we're gonna learn how to perform the hypothesis testing comparing the means of two independent populations and also the means of two related populations. In the end, we're gonna talk about how to compare the variances from two populations. So when we talk about the two populations, these two populations could be independent. You draw the sample from one population, doesn't affect the sample from the other population. They are completely independent. How to perform the test to comparing those two population mean. The other case is that we call it a paired sample. One situation is that actually we draw the sample from single one population, but one measurement is before certain situation. The other measurement is after the, some situation or some treatment. So you got a two measurements on the same subject. You're going to compare the difference between before and after. This is what we call the related or paired samples, right? Those two measurements from the same subject is, should be highly correlated. We call it a paired sample. Or sometimes we those two samples, although it's two independent samples, but when we design it, we can match their age or gender, match certain covariates. Then those two populations are not completely independent. They are correlated. Then we also need to using the paired t-test, the techniques the same as that one. So use that technique to perform the hypothesis testing on those two different population mean. So for example, let's see we are interested in the relationship between use of oral contraceptives and the level of blood pressure in women. And then the first design is that we follow up non-OC users and measure the change when they become OC users. For the same subject, we conduct some longitudinal study. For the same subject, we get the sample before they started using OC and after using OC. So for the same subject, we have two samples. We got the paired samples from single populations. So the same patients, each woman is used as her own control, so observed difference is more likely to be due to the OC use. So this is, in the case, we need to use the paired sample test to check the difference between those two population mean. The other situation is that we just collect the sample at the same time points. Some of them are OC user, some of them are non-OC user. Then we just compare the sample mean between those two samples. This is what we call the cross-sectional study design. And this is, we got the sample from two independent populations. The population has no relationship. We're gonna using the technique for those two independent samples. So we first talk about the paired t-test, which is used to perform the hypothesis testing for the paired population, two populations. When we talk about the related populations, we need to use the paired t-test. In this kind of study design, we have two related populations. And such like the paired samples, we got repeated measurements. We want to check the difference between those two repeated measurements. And the assumption for this test is that both populations are normally distributed. If not normal, in order to use this test, we need to make sure the sample size is very large, it's bigger than 30. For this example, say we first recruit 10 women who are not using OC. Then we follow up them. After 1 year of using OC, we get their blood pressure measurement before and after using OC. For each subject, we have two measurements. We want to compare the mean for not using OC, whether it's different from the one in the group of using OC. Because those two measurements belong to the same subject, we are actually looking at this difference, whether this difference is from zero or not, right? So for each subject, we first can calculate the difference between those two measurements. For each subject, we calculate the DI, this difference. And this, from this time point, this paired two population problem converted to a one population problem, right? So for each subject, although we have two measurements, we just looking at the difference of those two. We got this DI. For each subject, we have a DI. We just actually want to test on this DI. This become a one population problem. For this DI, we can calculate the sample mean of this DI. We call it D bar. And it's a number of pairs in the paired sample. And then if we assume the standard deviation for this difference is known, we can construct the test statistics in this way, using the known standard deviation. We're gonna using the standard normal test to test whether this difference is significantly from zero or not. If usually this standard deviation is unknown, we're just using the sample standard deviation to calculate the t-statistics. And then using the previous technique we just talked about for the one population sample mean hypothesis testing, we can perform the test, the same t-test, on this mean difference. So one sigma d is unknown, depends on your alternative hypothesis. We just decide which rejection region, whether it's one-sided or two-sided. Then here is the confidence interval for this difference. Whenever sigma d is known, whenever sigma d is unknown, you can construct the confidence interval. And here is what I want to go over. Here is the how to perform the paired t-test on it. We're still focusing on the difference. You can see for the difference, you calculate the critical point, critical value, just as we did in the previous test, for the degree of freedom 9. And because this is a two-sided test, the rejection region is decided by the two tails. And you get your critical value is -2.26 and +2.26. Then you calculate your test statistics using the difference between those paired sample. Your t statistics is 3.32. That one is not, actually it's in this side. It's bigger than the critical value. It's in the rejection region. Then we reject the non-hypothesis. Is that okay? So this is actually the same as the test we perform in the one population when we do the paired t-test. And this is defined the confidence interval. Here, next I want to show you how to use the two-pack, analysis two-pack in the Excel to perform the two-population test. If you want to using the Excel to do your homework, you first need to install this two-pack. This is come with Excel 2007, but it's not pre-installed. If you want to using this function, you need to first follow this link to install this analysis two-pack on your Excel. Then here's just an instruction. Before the following analysis is just using this analysis two-pack. Here I want to show you how to using Excel analysis two to perform the paired t-test we just performed in the previous slides. First, in your Excel, you input your data. You can see here these two columns, that's your original raw data. And then you select the data tab, then data analysis, then you will get a window popped up. There list a lots of different tests you can choose from. You just choose t-test, paired two sample for means. Then you will see this window. For this window, for the first variable, you just select the range of the first column, the first group. And the second range, for the second variable, is just for the column C. Then you click OK. Here's the output from the Excel. You need to know how to read this output. What's the meaning of those numbers in the output? In the output file, the first section just tells you the sample mean and the sample variance for those within each group. And the t-stat this part just gives you the t statistics calculated by the sample mean and the sample variance. And here reports the p-values. This problem is two tails, so you look at the p-values for the two tails. It's 0.008874. if you use the p-value method, you just compare this p-value with alpha. It's smaller than 5%, then you know your conclusion is that you reject your null hypothesis. If you want to use the critical value method, this is also tells you the critical value for the two tail. For this problem is 2.26. You can use that to draw your rejection region, then compare your t statistics within this rejection region determined by the critical value. If inside, you reject your null hypothesis. Otherwise, you accept your null hypothesis. Is that okay? So this way, how to read your output from your Excel, this is the one for the paired t-test. Next, I'm going to show you how to perform the t-test for the independent sample. For the independent samples, our goal is to test a hypothesis or form a confidence interval for the difference between two population means. In this case, those two samples are from two independent populations. The point statistic we're going to use is still the difference of the sample mean, x1 bar minus x2 bar. When we comparing the sample mean from two independent populations, there are the following three scenarios. Scenario one, both standard deviation, the population standard deviation, they are known, then it's going to be easy. We're going to use the z-test statistics using the standard normal distribution under the null to perform the hypothesis test. If sigma 1 and sigma 2 are unknown, but we can assume they are equal. Although they are unknown, but from those two groups, we assume their standard deviation are equal, then we need to first calculate the pooled, the overall sample deviation from the sample. Then we construct a t-statistics using this SP. If sigma 1 and sigma 2 is unknown, we also assume they are not equal. Then we need to estimate sigma 1 and sigma 2 using the sample variance separately. Then we construct our t-statistics using S1 and S2. Here we just go over those three situations one by one. When under this situation, sigma 1 and sigma 2 are both known, the assumption for the test is that samples are randomly and independently drawn, sample size should be large, then we're gonna using a z-value. And since sigma 1 and sigma 2 is known, we can calculate the standard error for sample mean using this formula. Then z-statistics can be constructed easily, and then we can perform the two population means. This is for the one-sided, one alternative with mu 1 less than mu 2. This is, we're gonna using the upper tail test is one in the alternative mu 1 is greater than mu 2. The third one is the two-tail test, depends on the H1. When mu 1 doesn't equal to mu 2, it's two-tailed test. So within each situation, we're gonna define their rejection regions. Depends on their H1, you decide which tail is its rejection region. For low-tail test, the rejection region is over there. For the two-sided, is on the two sides. So in this way, usually for the two-sided problem, we can also construct its confidence interval. It's like that. That is for sigma 1 and sigma 2 are known. Whenever sigma 1 and sigma 2 are unknown, we are mostly focusing on those two situations. Because in practice, usually the standard deviation is unknown. We need to estimate them using the sample variance. When sigma 1 and sigma 2 are unknown, but we can assume they are equal, then we're gonna first calculate the pooled variance. Under this assumption, sigma 1 equals to sigma 2, we first estimate sigma 1 using the sample from the first group, get the S1 square, and then we can similarly get S2 square, using that to calculate the pooled variance, using that one to construct your t-statistics. And after you construct your t-statistics, similarly, you can get your confidence interval. Here, so I just go over the details, mathematics, how to construct this t-test and the confidence interval. But actually, nowadays, we always use the software to perform that test. Here, I just want to show you how to using the software to get your desired results. This example, I use the same data, but I changed the assumption. Here, we assume those two samples are collected from two independent populations. One is the OC group, the other is non-OC group. Our goal is to compare these two population means. In this one, because we are talking about two independent population, and assume sigma 1 equals to sigma 2. So in the analysis two pack in Excel, you need to select the proper test. You want to use the t-test with two samples assuming equal variances. So right now, the key is that you understand your problem first and know exactly which test you're going to use to perform your hypothesis testing. One key thing is whether this population, two population are related or independent. The other thing is that whether the variance from two groups are equal or not. In this example, we're going to use t-test with two sample tests assuming equal variance. Then you decide the region you got such report. You can see in this report, it gives you pooled variance using the formula I just showed you in the previous slides. This is the way how they get this number. And they also tell you the t-statistics using the sample mean and the sample variance. And also it tells you the p-value and the critical point. So by looking at the p-value, actually you can draw your conclusion. You can using the previous outcome result to fill out your answer sheet here, right? So you know your null and alternative hypothesis, the degree of freedom is 18, the critical value from the previous slide output, you can get is 2.1. Or if you want to calculate it by yourself, you can using the t-inverse function to do it by yourself. And then you can define your rejection region. You got your observed t-statistics also from the output. Then you can make your decision, either comparing it with the rejection region, or you can calculate the p-value. The p-value you can also get from the output from the Excel. So for this example, the conclusion is that the mean blood pressure of the OC and the non-OC group do not significantly differ from each other. Is it okay? Actually, I don't require you to know exactly how to calculate those numbers. I want you understand in which situation, which test you should use, and then using any software to perform the proper test to get the result. After you get the result, how to explain, how to understand the outcome. After you get that outcome report, which part you should look into, the key part is the p-values. Assuming you are using the proper test, you got this result, you look at the p-value, compare it with the alpha. If smaller than alpha, you reject your null hypothesis. Otherwise, you just you do not reject your null hypothesis. So here is the second situation, when sigma 1 and sigma 2 are unknown. The third situation is that both sigma 1 and sigma 2 are unknown, and we assume they are not equal. Then when they are not equal, you're using this way to calculate your t-statistics. Yes. Right, we need to perform a test. I will gonna talk about that test after this one. So right now you decide sigma 1 and sigma 2 are not equal, then you gonna using the following t-test to comparing those two population mean. And in this situation, one specific part for the mathematics is that you need to get a different degree of freedom because you need to estimate sigma 1 and sigma 2 separately. It's going to use up some degree of freedom. The degree of freedom is different from the 1 in this situation. In that situation, it's just a total sample size minus 2, but in that situation, there's a formula to calculate the degree of freedom. But actually, I just show you the formula. You are not required to use that formula to really calculate this degree of freedom. Here's the confidence instant interval. The key thing here is that how to using the function, the analysis tool in itself. You're going to select this two sample test, t-test, assuming unequal variance. Under this two-pack analysis, you need to use this t-test. Using this t-test, you got the output. The same thing for the output, you're going to look at the p-value. It also reports the t-critical, the critical values here. You can use that to construct your rejection region. So my point here is that after you got the output, you need to know which part is corresponding to this answer sheet. What's the degree of freedom? You can know here, degree of freedom is 17. And what's the critical value? That number you can also get from the output, the test statistics, then using your decision strategy we just taught you in this lecture, you can draw the conclusion. Yes?
Why is the degree of freedom 17?
I just said that under this situation, because both sigma is unknown, you need to using the sample data to estimate sigma 1 and sigma 2 separately, then this is used up some degree of freedom. And I just show you the formula to calculate the degree of freedom. After using this formula, the degree of freedom for this situation is 17. It's not n minus 2. For this, the second scenario is just n minus 2. So here, this is for the third scenario. The last part corresponding to the student's question, how to determine which test we should use? How to determine whether the sigma 1 equals to sigma 2 or not. You need to using the F test to compare the population variances. So this is the last test we're going to talk about in this lecture. Here, we have two independent samples from two populations. The underlying assumption is that a normal distribution with mu 1 sigma 1 square. The other is normal distribution with mu 2 sigma 2 square. The problem is whether sigma 1 square equals to sigma 2 square. So the hypothesis is formalized like that. And the test statistics. So then intuitively, naturally, we're gonna using the sample variance to construct the test statistics about the population variance. So we're gonna look at the ratio of the sample variance between those two samples. So actually, this ratio, these statistics, follow a F distribution. We're gonna perform the test using this underlying F distribution. Under the null hypothesis, if this ratio is very large, very, very large, bigger than 1, that indicates this S1 is different from S2. S1 is far away bigger than S2. If it's also too small, that also indicate those two population variance are different. That is, if it's very, very small, less than 1, the ratio is very small, 0.00 something. That means S1 is really smaller than S2 squared. So the idea here is just using the F distribution to comparing the variance from the two independent population. And here is the picture of the F distribution. And I just said that to perform that test, the rejection region occurs on both two tails. The difference between F distribution with the normal distribution, you can see F distribution is not symmetric. It's asymmetric. So for the critical values, you need to calculate separately for each tails. But fortunately, actually, we can using the two-pack to perform the to perform the F test. Your job is just looking at the p value. Here is just the underlying theory about the F test. You can see this rejection region occurs on two tails. It's calculated by looking at the probability for the F distribution bigger or less than those two critical values. So here, just to show you how to get the analysis output from Excel, you still get these two group of raw data. You should call this function, this analysis, F-test to sample for variances. You got such output. One thing about this function, this F-test in Excel, is that it only reports the p-value for one tail. But in our purpose, we need to look at the two-sided test. How to get the two-sided p-values? You just multiply the one-sided p-value by two. Because one tail, this is just a one tail probability. If we looking at a two-sided hypothesis testing problem, you need to double it, count to the other side. Just using this p-value multiplied by two, just give you the p-value for the two-sided test. So then you're comparing this doubled p-value with alpha. If smaller than alpha, that is significant. Then you can decide which t-test you should use to compare the population mean. Is that okay? Although we talk about this F-test for the variance in the end, actually once you are given a two population mean hypothesis testing problem, first thing you need to decide whether they are paired population or independent population. If they are paired samples, then you need to use the paired t-test. Usually this sigma is unknown. Sigma is unknown, you use a paired t-test. You select this test to perform your analysis. If those two means, two samples are from two independent population, then you need to consider the independent t-test. But you need to first perform the F-test to compare those two population variance, whether they are equal or not. If they are equal, you choose the t-test with equal variance from the Excel. Otherwise, you just choose the t-test with two sample t-test with unequal variance. Is that okay? This is the flow of the test you're gonna use to comparing two sample population mean. Yeah, I know it's very intense for today's lecture. We have gone through lots of tests. So I suggest you to go over the slides by yourself after the class, and then understand the key part, understand under which situation, which proper test you should use to perform the hypothesis testing. Any questions? Yeah, if no question, that is for today's lecture.